Hi, my name is Kate Crowley. I'm a professor of practice here at Teachers College, Columbia University in New York City. Welcome to the Cleft Palate Speech and Feeding video tutorials that I've created with my co-authors, Dr. Miriam Baigorri and Ms. Chelsea Sommer. We've created these video tutorials for children who are born with cleft palates, but who may not have a speech therapist or speech pathologist available to address their speech issues. In addition, we've created them for those speech language therapists and speech pathologists who may want to acquire an understanding of how to work with children born with cleft palate. And finally, we especially want to thank the families and children who worked in our Advanced Cleft Palate Research Clinic here at Teachers College, Columbia University, to provide the videos that you're going to see throughout these video modules, seeing how we do speech therapy with these children born with cleft palate. Thank you so much. I hope you enjoy them. To begin our modules, I want to share with you our very first therapy session with Peyton and her mom, both of whom were featured throughout these video modules. Peyton was born with a cleft palate and recently had surgery for speech at 5 years old and had just been cleared for speech therapy. This short video demonstrates the important role the speech-language pathologist or therapist can have in the lives of children born with cleft palates. Say, say, ba.
Ma.
Ba, ba, ba.
Ma, ma, ma.
Ba.
Ma.
Good. So, Mom, you know we know it from what she just did? She can create the pa sound, and that means she can create every single sound.
Really?
And all we need now is speech therapy. Every single sound. That's what we know from that little bit. Welcome to Module 1 of Cleft Palate Speech and Feeding Video Tutorials. In this module, we're going to talk about anatomy and physiology, typically how it develops, and then anatomy and physiology of children with cleft. Now, before we start, I want to say why this is so important. When babies are born with a cleft, they have a hole in their mouths and they can't create closure in the back of their mouth. So their soft palate can't lift up and close back there, which is needed for many of the speech sounds. Pa, ta, ka, ga, sha, ja, s, ta, da. So because those sounds can't be made, the baby begins to make different sounds. And until the baby's palate is repaired and they can make those sounds appropriately, they develop these habits of making sounds in a different way. So what we're going to do now is go through a whole series of video tutorials, starting with the anatomy and physiology, so that you can see exactly what is happening internally and the whole process of providing appropriate services to children whose speech is impaired due to their cleft palate. Let's begin with looking at what happens in embryological development. So the lips and the alveolus begin at about 6 to 7 weeks of gestation. While they're in the womb, while the fetus is in the womb growing, the lips and alveolus are forming very early on. And it starts at a point called the incisive foramen, which is a very important part in the anatomy of cleft lip and palate development. The hard palate begins to form at 8 to 9 weeks of gestation. And the velum, the soft palate, and the uvula, that little thing that hangs down at the back of the throat, they're completely formed at about 12 weeks of gestation. So now we're going to look at what typical anatomy looks like before we look at what the anatomy of cleft lip and palate looks like. So here's an illustration done by Tina Young, and you can see the dental arch. Then the premaxilla is in that little triangle at the top, just under the nose. That's a very important thing, especially when children have bilateral cleft lips. You'll see that in the next module. After the premaxilla, we have the incisive foramen, that dot I told you about. That spot is actually how the lips and the palates fuse. It's sort of the beginning of the fusion point for the lips and the palate, more on that. Then we have the palatine processes of the maxilla, the palatine bone, the posterior nasal spine, the palatine foramen, the hamulus, and here's two muscles, the tensor veli palatini, which many of us know, it's the muscle that opens and closes the eustachian tube, which connects the mouth to the middle ear. So if you travel and you're on a plane and you need to yawn, what's happened is the tensor veli palatini has not opened up the eustachian tube to actually regulate the pressure between the airplane and what's happening in your middle ear. Very important with kids with cleft palate, because often that muscle is displaced. So many kids with cleft palate have lots of conductive hearing loss. The levator veli palatini, or as everyone who's taken a cleft palate course with me knows, the levator veli palatini, because that muscle is the muscle that really is the primary muscle in soft palate closure. It lifts up and back the soft palate to close against the posterior pharyngeal wall, more on that, and the uvula, which is that little piece that hangs down. Here's how the muscles work. This is not all the muscles, but most of the muscles. So the velum is in green, and that velum has to go up and back to the posterior pharyngeal wall for closure. There's also the lateral walls are moving in, but we can't do that with a profile picture. So the velum goes up against the posterior pharyngeal wall. Then we have the glossopalatini, or the palatal glossus, which pulls the velum down when it needs to move down. We also have the palatopharyngeus. That's mostly used for swallowing rather than speech, but it's not quite, has not been fully ruled out as having some use in velopharyngeal closure. Then, of course, the famous levator veli palatini and the constrictor pharyngeal superior, or the superior pharyngeal constrictor. And those muscles move the lateral pharyngeal walls in. There's another muscle called the muscula uvulae. It's at the tip of the velum, at the very tip of that green. And when the palate is being raised for velopharyngeal closure, it bulges the tip of the velum and also makes it a little bit stiff. So what does the typical anatomy of the oral structure look like? Well, we've got the hard palate, the soft palate or velum, the uvula back there, and the tongue. We also look at the outside, because when a child has a cleft lip, the outside of the face can be involved. So we have the nasal aperture, the columella, which is this cartilage between the tip of the nose and this part of the face, the nares, the openings, the philtrum, which is this line, the kind of a depression of a line. It actually is a depression that goes in between the two seams that would, if they're open, you'd have a cleft lip. And then the Cupid's bow. So how do the oral structures develop? The reason we have that beautiful jacket there is because of the zipper that closes it. So now we're talking about the incisive foramen. The incisive foramen is a point in the palate from which the lips fuse and from which the palate fuses. Now imagine that yellow dot is the bottom of the zipper. And there's a zipper that starts at the yellow dot and goes up to the nose and closes the one side of the lips. Then another zipper starts on the other side and closes up. And then the palate starts at that yellow dot. That's the base of the zipper for the palate also, but that closes from front to back. So the lips close from the incisive foramen forward, and the palate closes from the incisive foramen back. Why that is important is when we start to look at cleft palate and cleft lip, we'll be able to see more clearly what happened anatomically. What I love to do when I teach my classes is to just look in people's palates, because they're all so different. So here's a couple of pictures of palates, but you can also do this with your friends. It's a way of really getting to know people on a way you never did before, usually, which is to look at their palate and their uvula. So have a look. Get your lights out and have a look.
Here's a few beautifully functioning palates that look quite different.
So that's the end of Module 1.1. The next module is 1.2, where we're going to look at the anatomy and physiology of different types of clefts. Again, this is from leadersproject.org, and there's many materials there. If you just came into this one module and you want to see all the modules, go to leadersproject.org, and they will all be there.